Today we're going to unbox the Asus ROG Strix B650i and go over some of the basic features, followed by CPU, CPU frame, and RAM installation. We will start it up, run an R23 benchmark, then I will compare this board on paper with the MSI B650i. Inside the box you will find the Asus ROG keychain, Wi-Fi antenna, USB 2.0 splitter, extra M.2 thermal pad, SATA cable, M.2 support bracket, extra M.2 latch, front audio extension cable, zip ties, user manual, Asus web storage information sheet, stickers, and lastly, the Armory Crate information card. On the board, we have the 8-pin CPU power connector, CPU overvolt, CPU fan header, AIO pump fan, chassis fan, 4 and 3-pin RBG header, 24-pin motherboard power, USB 2.0 header, 2 SATA headers, 3.2 Gen 2 USB-C header, USB 3.0 Gen 1 header, front power and reset button header, front audio header, and of course the PCI 5.0 slot. Two DIMM slots that support up to 64 gigs DDR5 6400 if you can get it to post at that speed. HDMI port, two USB A, two USB C, four USB 3.2 Gen 2, one Intel 2.5 gigabit Ethernet port, Wi-Fi 6E antenna port, audio ports, BIOS Flex, and the flex key. As for expansion, the M.2 underneath this plate supports PCI 5.0. Then the PCI slot on the back runs off the chipset at PCI 4.0. As for the CPU, we're using the 7900X3D. We will also use a CPU frame because just like the 12th and 13th gen Intel, there's an issue with the ILM deflecting the top of the CPU lid and creating an uneven surface for the CPU cooler contact. These have been proven to work well for the 12th and 13th gen Intels, and I expect the same results with this setup. As for memory, we're installing 32 gigabytes of Triton Z5 Neo RBG 6000 MHz CL36 RAM. These timings are a little on the loose side, so we may adjust the voltage and try to get them a little tighter later on. Before starting it up for the first time, we had to update the BIOS. Keep this in mind with the X3D chips. This motherboard luckily has a nice BIOS flashback feature where a CPU or memory doesn't have to be installed to update it. As for posting, it took about 3 minutes for it to post into the BIOS for the first time. Now let's run a Cinebench R23 benchmark. We are doing a 10-minute run to test thermals. As for cooling, we are using a 240mm radiator with thermal grizzly. Reason for this size is because it's going in a micro ATX case, which is also why we chose an ITX motherboard. During the test, the room temperature was 22.2 degrees Celsius and 22.4 by the end. The reason why I annotate that is also for monitoring thermals, but later on, I would like to throw the factory ILM back on and compare results without the CPU frame installed. As for temperatures, it is running exceptionally cool in the low 80s with all cores a hair over 4.8 gigahertz. To be fair, running the screen capture did take some resources, but it was marginal. It scored a 27,423 without the background programs running. Now to compare with the 12900KS, which is still a very powerful and competitive processor, it scored only 200 points lower than that. Now compared to a 13th gen Intel, this score is roughly 2400 points higher than a 13700F. Keep in mind, these numbers really don't matter as much for gaming as this chip is designed for. Therefore, we will run a 3D Mark GPU benchmark in the future and compare the results with another PC I have with a 13900KF. But still, not bad numbers at all for what it's worth. In comparison to the 5900X, this is roughly 5,000 points higher. So it will still get the job done for multitasking and day-to-day computing very well. With all that said, this CPU still doesn't have a good performance to dollar. Maybe later down the road with some BIOS updates and price drops, but as for right now, I do not recommend this chip. Now, if you're looking to save about $100 on the MSI MPG B650i, I don't recommend that, and here's why. Mainly because it only has PCIe 4.0 and PCI 4.0 expansion slots. Gen 5 M.2 drives are right around the corner from being affordable, and read and write speeds are up to 12,000 megabytes a second. Gen 5 GPUs will be coming out at the end of this year, and that might hurt some people's feelings who just overpaid for their 4090. So, a future upgrade path for those two components simply don't exist. In addition, the MSI board has an 8+2+1 VRM power, where the Asus board is a 10+2 to feed power-hungry processors and memory with cleaner power. Where the MSI board has two extra SATA headers, it lacks two USB ports on the back, and I'd rather have the extra USB connections. For those who like their flashy lights, you also lose one RGB header going with the MSI board. If these differences don't matter to you, then the MSI board is not a bad option to save $100. For me personally and the computers that I sell, I will stick with the Asus on this one. I really appreciate y'all taking out the time and watching my videos and supporting the channel. If you haven't heard yet, we're giving away that computer at the end of the table. I can't wait to give it to one of you lucky viewers on the 26th of March, 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. We'll go live to announce the winner. Hope to see y'all there, and until then, we'll see you next time.